We're continuing our really a year-long theme on growth by talking about growing through challenges. Growing through challenges. Anyone here ever experienced challenges in life? Oh, some hands didn't go up. Wow. Anyone here would like to grow through your challenges? Excellent. Well, I'm speaking to the right audience then, okay? Because that's me. I go through challenges in life, and my hope, my prayer is that I can grow from them instead of just feel set back by them or stuck in them. As long as I've been a Christian and going to the scriptures for guidance and for encouragement, the Bible challenges my perspective on challenges. And it takes a maturing and transforming work of God's Spirit to alter the way I think about and process experiencing trials and challenges. Here's just a couple things that I've grown in, or we'll say am growing in, as the work continues to progress in my heart and in my soul when it comes to coming up against or experiencing challenges in life. Sometimes I can assume that there's a way to outsmart challenges in life. That I can get to a point of maturity where I figure out a way through life that just avoids and goes around all the challenges that there are. But I realize that this is impossible. Jesus' commands certainly help me to avoid some kinds of self-inflicted challenges that come from sin. But then following Jesus' commands actually leads me then right smack into other kinds of challenges that are unavoidable. And I realize that that's a myth. It's a myth that I can somehow figure out this golden path through life that is challenge-free and trial-free. Sometimes when I'm going through challenges or trials, I assume that it's punishment for doing something wrong or a consequence for having failed, when the opposite can very well be true. That challenges and trials come because what is happening is right. And because in this life and in this world, many times what is good and what is right meets opposition. And what the scriptures say, the faith is the good fight of faith. I'm quick to assume that challenges always mean setbacks, when I'm starting to realize that challenges can actually be opportunities, great opportunities, to catapult forward in growth and change and learning in ways that could not otherwise be available. So I know for me it's a work in progress. It's a work in progress to grow, mature, and evolve in my understanding of challenges. And I want to share some thoughts from the book of 1 Peter that have been valuable to me, that I hope will be valuable to all of us as well, to give us some thoughts about growing through challenges. Let's look at 1 Peter chapter 1. We grow by the power of perspective. 1 Peter chapter 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to God's elect, strangers in the world, scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through the sanctifying work of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ and sprinkling by his blood, grace and peace be yours in abundance. Praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now, for a little while, you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. But these have come so that your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and
honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Concerning this salvation, the prophets who spoke of the grace that was to come to you searched intently and with the greatest care, trying to find out the time and circumstances to which the Spirit of Christ in them was pointing when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you, when they spoke of the things that have now been told you by those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Even angels long to look into these things. We'll stop right there. The power of perspective. Putting our challenges and trials in perspective of the greater salvation that we have. When you're going through a hard time, and it's really challenging and it really hurts, isn't it just so easy to just kind of focus in the moment on that thing? And we just kind of get tunnel vision about that, right? It's kind of like the only thing that's happening in life, or the only thing that's just happening in our experience, is just this really challenging and painful thing. And part of growing through challenges is learning how to grow in taking that big picture and broader perspective, the context of our challenges. The book of 1 Peter was written in the mid-60s AD, around 63-64 AD. What kinds of trials were the Christians experiencing during this time, the audience of this epistle? Well, Christians at this time were considered outcasts and heretics in the Jewish communities that they were born and raised in, and where they held all of their identity. It was already hard enough for the Jews of the day to maintain a community and an identity overwhelmed by the Gentile world. Now, the Christians among them were being put out, losing the only identity and community that they had had. Not only cast out, but some were suffering violence and persecution as a result. Add to that, at this time, a new form of persecution that was coming from Rome. Nero, who was emperor at the time, demanded emperor worship, which the Christians would not give. And as the reign of Nero progressed, he became more unstable and exhibited more and more indications of insanity. And eventually, under Nero, the first widespread official persecution of Christians broke out, and they were put to death in violent and bloody ways. And the church at this time, it had no established legacy or history, no political clout of any time, of any kind, no network of allies in larger society, and no status as a recognized religion in Rome. Now, as this was happening, you can imagine that the Christians began to ask some tough questions. If this Christianity thing is from God, and it's true, and God is supposed to be with us, why are we suffering and being opposed in this way? Have you ever felt that way as a Christian? You ever had thoughts like that? Man, if this is right and this is true, then why is being a Christian, or promoting Christianity, so challenging at times? But you know, it's not a new or unique struggle. It's one that was shared by the family of God 2,000 years ago. And what it does is it gives us perspective. You know, today we feel the uncertainty of large-scale political votes and democratic exercises, like Brexit, for instance. Or maybe, I know some of us were from the United States, from elections that are coming up in the United States, which look to be some of the most tumultuous elections, at least in my lifetime, that I can remember. But can you imagine living as a Christian at the time when this was written? When the uncertain whim of an insane emperor who held all authority spelled your fate. One day you're fine, and the next day, just like that, without any say or any recourse, you're put in prison and made to die in a public spectacle.
just because someone feels like it. You know, today we can feel the sting of people who decide they don't like us as Christians, right? Or they don't like our church, or they may view us with skepticism. But it's amazing because, you know, I realize that the perspective, I still have the backing of a large movement of great churches and Christian partnerships. I have technology that I can access people all around the world for support and encouragement. If I have a bad day as a Christian, there's like, you know, a dozen ministers that I could just get on FaceTime immediately from everywhere and just get some encouragement and get some support. Could you imagine being a Christian at this time? Right? Where it was all brand new, and they were exposed and they were vulnerable. And there was no allies, there was no partnerships, and no access to other people, except for the occasional letter like this that came through the community to be read from time to time. Perspective helps us to grow through challenges. You know, just this past week, I felt under a lot of stress and pressure at times. We had the great event of Hope Youth Corps being in time. But of course, then, as many of us know, we also had to go through a local move during that time. And, just picking up with a family of five and getting everything packed and getting everything moved and getting everything unpacked and just sort of making it all happen and the upheaval. And boy, it was stressful. And I was anxious. And I felt like under challenge and trial at times. I was like, this is like the worst timing of the year to do this, right? Well, Youth Corps is in town, and there's all this crazy stuff going on, right? But you know, I have to have perspective. Because when I step back and think about it, what's really going on? I get to move from one great place to another great place. You know what I was experiencing? It's what I call the stress and challenge of the wealthy and the blessed. I mean, that's what it is. I got to move into the West End, into a nicer flat. Right? Sometimes the stresses and the challenges that we feel in life and that we lose, are we going to put these things in perspective?
That's right.
Are they the challenges of the wealthy and the blessed? We can stress about, oh, the job is so stressful sometimes. We're grateful to have a job. Grateful to live in a first world developed country and to even have a job. We can feel so stressed out about our families. Oh, my spouse and the kids. That's all driving me nuts, right? But man, those of us in those situations, we're blessed to have.
Yeah.
Blessed to have a spouse. Blessed to have children. You know, there are Christians, again, in the first century, and then other people around the world even today who, you know, who just, they lose these things. It's not a matter of moving from one place to a nicer part of town. It's a matter of losing your place and then having nothing. That's what the Christians were like here. When they lost what they had, they were persecuted. They were put out of their communities, run out of their towns and communities. They had nothing. And the idea is not to ignore the stuff that happens in life that we feel challenged by. I felt challenged by the move I had to do. I mean, that was real stress and it was real distraction. But it's a matter of being able to be grounded in our challenges. Put them in the bigger picture perspective of things. So that way, man, we can navigate through them as opposed to feeling defeated by them. You know, this passage in 1 Peter chapter 1, I call this to myself the 1 in 12 challenge. You know what I appreciated about these 12 passages that I just read? While all this that I described was going on with the Christians, only one verse in 12 actually gives mention to the trials and sufferings that they're undergoing. Did you notice that? I mean, Peter opens up and he's just bursting with praise and he's bursting with thanksgiving. He's bursting with, man, how blessed we are, right? And then he's got this one passage and he's like, man, you know, those of us who may have had to suffer some trials, you know, in the short run. He's got it in perspective. The 1 in 12 challenge. For every one thought that I had that brings up a challenge or a trial that I may be facing, I want to have 11 other thoughts that are focused on the big picture perspective of God's salvation. How different would my life be? How different would my faith be if I held to that? For every one negative, distressed thought about my challenges, there were 11 others that focused on the big picture of God's calling. The big picture of the salvation that's coming from Jesus Christ.
the big picture, right, of his love and his goodness for us, the big picture of the larger plan communicated by the scriptures and what we have in store, that would change me. That perspective would help me grow and get through challenges in an incredible way. You know, at the end of this, in verse 13, he says, therefore, prepare your minds for action, be self-controlled, set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Jesus Christ is revealed. Now, that's a powerful thought right there. Set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Jesus Christ is revealed. You know, some of the hard lessons that I've learned in life, it's about things that I put my hope in that end up disappointing. And sometimes I realize that's where my suffering, that's where my trials come from. And what I realize from this passage is that there's hopes with a little h, and then there's hope with the big capital H. Life is filled with hopes that have a little h. Hope the politics and economics of our situation can sort themselves out. Hope that I find a good job that I like with a boss that is fair and reasonable. Hope that I'll find support from loved ones in times of need. Hope that when I go out and ask someone if they want to come to church, they'll say, yes, thanks, instead of looking at me like I have four eyes, right? Hope that someone who is a friend will stay a friend. Hope that those who make a commitment to a relationship will honor that. Hope that my favorite team will win the Euro. Well, that hope has been dashed, right? But the point is that there's all these hopes that we have in life, but these hopes need to be hopes with a little h. And the only hope with a capital H, with a big H that we're supposed to have, is on the grace of God that is to be revealed. That's it. There's only one hope that we totally give our hearts and our souls over to. And that's a hope that keeps us in perspective. The big hope. The hope of God's grace that is to be revealed. And then once we get the right perspective, we can get grounded in perspective that helps us grow. We have to learn how to suffer well. I'm going to just read some excerpts here from the next few chapters in 1 Peter. This is in chapter 2, verses 19 to 23, where he gives us the example of Christ. For it is commendable if a man bears up under the pain of unjust suffering because he's conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. And to this you are called because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his footsteps. He committed no sin and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. Let's skip over in chapter 3 and verse 13. Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you're blessed. Do not fear what they fear. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. It is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. And in chapter 4, verse 1, therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves also with this same attitude. Because he who has suffered in his body is done with sin. As a result, he does not live the rest of his earthly life for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God. Look in verse 12. Dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you're insulted because of the name of Christ, you're blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you.
If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer, a thief, or any other kind of criminal, or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. We'll stop right there. See, learning how to suffer well has to do with suffering for the right purpose and with the right heart. This is what Jesus did. Suffering, again, is not an avoidable option in life. It's just a reality, and it's inevitable. Jesus is the only example of someone that we have who lived a perfect life. No one will ever improve on the life that Jesus lived. And yet, it still involved suffering, didn't it? But it was an example of suffering well. Because the hope and the promise of Christianity is not an end around pain and suffering, but it's that suffering can have a good and noble purpose and will ultimately result in salvation and glory to God. Pain and suffering for the right reasons can actually be very good, right? Hurt hurts, but that doesn't mean it's always bad. Anyone ever been through a rigorous workout or gone to the gym and left feeling in pain and left feeling hurt? Well, why'd you do that? Why'd you do that to yourself? And then knowing what it involves, why do you go back and do that to yourself again and again? And then why do you sometimes pay money to other people to have them do that to you? Are we insane?
Yeah.
Yeah, someone said yeah, right? Someone who's still recovering from a workout. No, we're not insane. We take the time to do this and to purposefully do this because we know that there is a purpose in mind, right? We know there's a purpose. We know that it's going to stimulate growth and change that we want to have, and it's inevitable that we got to go through the hard times to get there. And there's a spiritual parallel there, too. We've got to suffer well. For the right reasons and with the right heart, as these scriptures say, because this is Christ's example. What were the reasons that Jesus suffered? Well, because he was just doing God's will and he was trying to do good for others. And he suffered as a result. And then he did it with the right heart. As the passage says, they hurled their insults at him. He didn't respond, he didn't retaliate. When we experience suffering, we can't be resentful. We can't retaliate. But we learn how to suffer well. In closing here, just want to read verse 19. Because then this is where this lesson about going through challenges really ends up coming to a conclusion. So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. Never stop. That's the lesson. Never stop fighting a good fight. Never stop giving. Never stop loving. Never stop sacrificing. Never stop trying. Never stop praying for others. Never stop hoping in God. Commit yourself to your faithful Creator the way that Jesus did on the cross and continue to do what is good. Because we may experience trials and challenges and setbacks, or what feel like setbacks as a Christian, but when we never stop, we always win. Let's grow for the challenges. Amen.